So now we are in this Advent season, and it's our second Sunday of Advent. And we're learning about those different names that we have from our God, and especially the ones that we have found on Isaiah. And we have been talking about how deep and how important is the name and why we have special names. And I know some of you told me during the week, my name had nothing special. Well, maybe your name, the fact that it's in you, starts something special in history in your family. But also besides the names that we have as people, we have some kind of nicknames. How many of you have a nickname? You know, I mean, if you know, my name is not Lupina. My name is Guadalupe, and I have the hardest time when I need to show some documents and explain that I am the same human. Guadalupe, Lupina is the same. But also there are other nicknames that you receive based on your role in the family, like grandmothers. All of you who are grandmas, raise your hand. Now tell me how did they call you. Nana, what else? Mimi. Mimi? What else? Gigi? Grammy? Mimo, did I hear one time Oma? There are some Oma, right? Is it German, right? You know, what else? Hmm? Lona, abuela, is there any abuela here? No? Like that's in Spanish. Abuelita, Wita. Yeah, I remember Wita. Like I would call my grandma Rogi, and it wasn't quite nice. It was because she was chubby. And then, and in Spanish, Rogi means, Rogisa means chubby. So we will call her Rogi all the time. And my children call to my mother Bertix. And that's like a kind of a, they built the name of my mother, Berta, and put it on a Bertix. So she's Bertix. So all these names, but don't you enjoy having that nickname? I mean, that you carry that with pride, like all grandmas, I know. And as soon as you hear that little voice telling you, Mommy, Nini, Guerguita, you melt, I know. And then you give them many things to your children that you didn't do to your child, to your grandkids, so they didn't do to your child, right? I know, that's part of history here. But those names carry a specific meaning. And they bring a specific title of actions that you take or roles that you play in life. This is the same thing we find in the Bible, especially with the names that we have been learning in Isaiah. These are the names that were given to a king and the expectations. When you give that name, it's not that you think that person is fulfilling everything. You are actually expecting. This is how we want you to be. This is the behavior we expect from you. And in the case that we see in Isaiah, like we're expecting you to be that wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Now, a lot of them will fulfill, but we were specifically looking here for one who could fulfill all of them, and we find that in the Lord Jesus Christ. Last week, we learned about the wonderful counselor. Now, as wonderful counselor, we remember that this is the meaning of one who brings order. And how does that happen? How is it possible that brings order? It is through wisdom, the way that he governs his kingdom, through the authority, through wonder, to understand in the case of Jesus, the capacity that Jesus has to do miracles that nobody else does. And through those followers who also proclaim the truth of God. Today we're going to talk about mighty God. Now, mighty God, it's also important to see within that understanding of who was a king. And you see, there is one series in Netflix that I really enjoy watching, but it just didn't have a lot of seasons. And it was called The Crown. Did you ever watch, anyone here watch The Crown? I like it, didn't you? And it's not totally 100% true. There are some aspects that are true, some aspects are not. Every time I watch it, as soon as I finish it, I was Googling and checking, is it really true this or not? But it's about Queen Elizabeth. And one of the things what I saw while we were watching that was all that coronation moment of her. Now, I don't know if any of you here remember when that happened, because it was in the 1950s when she has been. So she has been probably one of the longest person who has been as a queen in history in the kingdom. I think so. If not, it's probably one of the closest there, because right now she's in her 90s. And this happened when she was in her 20s, I think. So she has been there for a while. But when I was looking at it, and the words and all the processional and all the people involved, then you realize this coronation has more than just a political aspect. There are a lot of expectation that the person who's receiving this crown is a person who's going to have a direct connection with God. It's actually an anointing aspect on it. And all the process is done not from a president to her, but from who? Have you seen that? It's from actually one of the bishops of the Anglican Church. So there is a spiritual aspect on there, because one of the beliefs is this, that whoever is carrying that crown, there is a divine power with that person. That person is becoming, in other words, like a direct connection with God, and it's expected that this person is able to listen to God and through that being able to empower and deal with all his kingdom, knowing that it's dependent in God's strength to do that. Now, we know that all the queens and kings that we have all are limited. But when we're looking at these idols in the eyes of who the Lord Jesus Christ is, things are different. In him, we find exactly who is that effective king. Now, this title of the mighty God is very special when you see that in the translation on the original word. It is actually El Gibor. It's the God that is a mighty warrior. So what you see when he's saying, we expect you to be a mighty God, is expecting to him to be that God who's a mighty warrior, capable to be able to bring his kingdom and fight for his kingdom and bring to his kingdom some hope. When I was listening to that and I was learning about it, it came to my, I remember that movie of The Lord of the Rings. And I have shared with you before about that, and that my husband enjoys watching that over and over. You know, and there is this guy, Aragorn, that's the way you call him, anyone who has watched it. And Aragorn actually models a good king. What he's trying to do is he's trying to bring his people, not just with the desire of gaining power, but he's actually trying to fight what we call the right battle. He's trying to fight that right battle. And what we see in what's going on with Isaiah is trying to say, let me show you what are the results and the expectations and the desires of that good king. And in Psalm 72 that we read today, he's telling us, this is how I believe a good king will look like, and the kingdom of that king will look like. And it's a big contrast. It's a big contrast with how people were looking in a successful kingdom or in a successful king. Because usually, whoever was thinking on a good king was a person who was winning a lot of wars, had a very strong economic situation, and they were strong in money. They also were very productive, and also they had a justice system that was usually benefit just some people in that area. So these are the characteristics that in any other kingdom were expected to be successful. But here we find that in God, these are not the characteristics of a successful kingdom. What we find in him is a very, very drastic contrast. What we find in him is the one who is a good king is the one who's capable to bring chaos to shalom. And you see, chaos to shalom. Maybe the best example that we can find of one of those visual places is that scene of Jesus when he needs to calm the storm. You remember that, right? He is there with his disciples, and what he's doing while the storm is starting, what is he doing? Sleeping. Sleep. Can you sleep in a storm? Any of you, right? You know, he's sleeping in the middle of the storm, and what's going on with the disciples? They are freaking out. They are scared. They are like, okay, Jesus, yeah, enough with your nap. I know you have been tired. You have done a lot of great things, but look what's going on right here. I don't know if you see the face of Peter over there. That's me 100% in storms. Like, what is happening, right? So here we find Jesus standing up with full authority and bringing this chaotic situation of the storm. And just by him standing up there and talking to that storm, all this chaotic situation became a shalom, became a peace and a place of balance. The water was still there, right? He didn't disappear the water. The water was still there, but he was able to bring that to a shalom. How many of us have been there? How many of us probably today we're feeling that we are in a storm? And we're just praying that here we have this mighty God coming, and just by his voice and authority, he's bringing shalom. But you see, I have been also thinking about my life, and I don't know if that happens to you guys, but the big storms sometimes are easier to recognize them. When you see, even within the news, here is this big, big thunderstorm coming, and there is a hurricane coming, and you're preparing for that, and you are putting everything ready because there is this one coming, and it's going to come and can hurt you. Those ones, you are kind of starting to be prepared, and you are aware of them, and you can fight them better thanks to the new system of weather and so. The ones that are difficult is the ones that are constant. Not that big, but they are constantly there. And those sometimes are the ones that make me more tired. Does it make sense? Like the one we had on Friday. There was not a big storm, but it was heavy. But it gets on your way. And I was thinking about my life and thinking, sometimes I have had humongous big storms, but I have also seen how God has prepared us to there. But there are times when I feel a lot of constant smaller storms that actually drive me. Are you there with me? Has it happened to you when you say, it's not just dealing with one big thing? It's harder when you are dealing with a lot of little things or smaller things that actually those are the ones who come and really hurt your spirit more. So it is on those kind of storms, regardless of the size, where you want to say, God, I need you to come with your mighty God, as the mighty God, and with your hand, and calm this storm. And what we see in this Isaiah prophecy is that assurance that the God that we have is capable to do that, to bring a shalom to all of us. And what's special is, how is he doing this? And we find in the scripture, if we read also chapter 72 on Psalms, verses 1 and 2, it says, endow the king with your justice, O God, the royal son with your righteousness. May he judge your people in righteousness, your afflicted ones with justice. Now, what is he doing? For he will deliver the needy who cry out, the afflicted who have no one to help. He will take pity on the weak and the needy and save the needy from death. He will rescue them from oppression and violence, for his precious is their blood in his sight. You see, this king is not talking that his success is coming because, oh, you know, I have a big army and I'm going to fight strong. He's talking about recognizing those that nobody sees, bringing justice in places that are unjust. That's how he's going to be successful. Now, he has two specific elements to be able to do this. And what are the words that we see here? Justice and what? And righteousness. Those are the two elements where God is capable to show himself as a mighty God in our lives, through his justice and through his righteousness too. Now, these two words, you can find them many times in the Bible, and they come together. They are a combo. Like, you know, in HEB, the combo loco? Well, these are the Bible combos. And like many times you can find the mercy of God, walking with the love of God. Also, you find justice and righteousness. And sometimes when you look at them, many people think that are the same thing. And I don't believe that. There are certain things that are different on them. And I'm going to try to explain what I see that is different in them. The righteousness of God is what is called also the distributive justice. In other words, it's being proactive. It's God being intentional in showing it first. Now, justice is what is retributive justice, and that is reactive. Does it make sense? I have pastors here, Nancy and Bob. Does it make sense? Let me explain you on Mexican hillbilly, because that's the way I can understand things that are difficult. So, what I'm going to do is this. All of you are familiar with this, right? These are what we call Christmas tree skirts or the second bed of cats, depending on what you have. If you have a cat, you have it there for sure. Right, okay. So what is happening, what I see is wherever you put this in your house, and I'm sure many of you, if you have a Christmas tree, you have one of these, right? Wherever you put this one in your house, what you are doing is you are proclaiming that space to be the Christmas tree space, correct? In other words, you're gonna, that's why it has a hole in the center, because in that way you put the tree and you say everything around here is about the tree, not the cats, but the cats are not gonna understand that. So give up on that one. But so you're saying, I'm using this space to say this has a specific reason of why this is here. And everything that is here is related to that Christmas tree. That is what I believe as the righteousness of God. It is God coming and telling us, all of you humans, all people, all my creation, I want you to hear that I love you and you are mine and I want you to be the people of God. That righteousness is God, is God coming to all of us and saying to the evil and saying to the devil, these people are mine and I'm going to fight for them. I am proclaiming this as righteousness, as saying, because I am a God who loves his creation, because I am a God who cares for everything that is in this world, I'm proclaiming this as my land, as the land where the love of God will be given to all who comes here. The only thing is we can choose to be part of that righteousness or not. I can choose to be inside of that skirt or not if I want to. Now, so that's the righteousness of God, telling this is my space, and this is my people, this is my kingdom that I'm caring for. But then, the justice, what I believe, the justice is when you start looking in here, kind of my cats, and you say, you really don't belong here. I'm gonna set you aside. Don't come in here, and I'm gonna put a spray. So every time you come here, I'm not gonna let you come in. Right? Because you are not part of this. That's justice. Justice is defining for this to be, maintain its integrity. Justice is going to say this belongs here or not. In our case as people, justice of God is a way to say, because I care so much for you. I care for your life. And there are things in your life that are getting in your way to grow as the person that I create you to be. So let's deal with that. Let's talk about it. Let me show you the strength that you can receive through the Holy Spirit so you can deal with that and get rid of it. Know that I have the power to tell you as your God, as your mighty God, I can calm that shalom, that chaos that you have so you can grow and thrive. I'm gonna teach you how to deal with a new normal now that you have something different in your life. Because of the loss of somebody, because of a loss of health, because of situations that you cannot quite understand. Why are they going on like this? It is God in his justice saying, you know, let me help you to deal with that. So we can come to a place where you are healthy. Perhaps not the same person, a different person, more mature within these situations, but healthy. So because of his justice, he's not going to allow those things hurt you, and he's going to ask you to deal with that. In that justice too, what happens too is when you are inside of that place, you start changing, isn't it? When you come to have a relationship with God, when you are part of the kingdom of God, the way you see life is very different. You start realizing, I don't need to care about if I have a big house or a small house, that's not a priority. It's a gift from God, and I'm blessed by that, but that's not going to define who I am. If I have a great husband or not, if I'm divorced or not, if I'm dealing with health issues, if my children are good or bad, that's not going to define me anymore. What defines me is that the Lord in his love, he put me inside of this kingdom, and by his mercy, I'm receiving his love, and my life is making sense in a different way. And I know that I have the blessing of an eternal life through him. But because I'm also here, I cannot see the world in the same way. I cannot react to the world, and I shouldn't react to the world in the same way that other people. I'm gonna start, as my kingdom is shaping me, I'm gonna start looking outside and saying, you know, that's not right. You know, we can treat people like this. You know, I cannot just go home and think it's okay when I see this happening. You know, I cannot just be the other coworker who keeps treating bad that nasty coworker that everybody hates and just add another person in that list of hating that person? I can't do that. I cannot be the one who's not doing the job well. I cannot be the one who reacts just to the nastiness of people around me. I'm gonna be the one proactive in showing that justice of God and that love of God. So because of that, we remember that our life is in a different set. We belong to a different place. Therefore, we are react in different ways to the realities of the world. But you see, what we need to remember is, who is the center? In our lives, the center is not just a Christmas tree. Who's the center of your life, my brother and sister? Think honestly about it. Who's the center of your life? If it's the Lord Jesus Christ, it is through his kingdom, it is through his power that your life is defined. It is through his power that your life is defined. The scripture says in Romans 3:22, that God setting things right that we read about has become Jesus setting things right for us. And not only for us, but for everyone who believes in him. So when we talk about that mighty God, you remember that what we find in the Lord Jesus Christ is a God that with all his power to the point of the cross, he's coming to bring you to his kingdom, to be able to bring righteousness for you and justice so that your life can be transformed, but that you can see this world through his eyes and transform this world through his power. Are you want to be part of that kingdom? Or do you want to live in your own? And I encourage you through this Advent to walk toward that kingdom, to stay in that righteousness and justice, and to become a powerful instrument of God to do justice for his glory. Amen.